So Shannon, does this all make you like Baker more or less here?
My stance hasn't changed on Baker. Baker's a front runner. And it's easy to say he's already told you how he felt about Daniel Jones, Skip, when they drafted the kid last year. Mm-hmm. I can't believe they took that kid, that guy.
That was a GQ interview.
Yes. Yep. That's what he's saying. When he thought it was off the record, mm-hmm. he told you how he felt about Daniel Jones.
And the reporter had just sat down to dinner.
Right.
And he looked up at the TV, and there was a report on ESPN.
They're taking Daniel Jones.
It's after the draft.
Right.
But he just made the offhand remark, I can't believe they took Daniel Jones.
Right.
Which was obviously what his true feelings.
What his true feelings were. Yeah. Now he wants to like, oh, yeah, man, he can tuck it and run now. He might not make it all the way to the end zone. But, Skip, this is what we know about Baker. Baker's a front runner. Mm. Where was all this? Where's this germ major? Where was all this running down the field last year, Skip? Did Baker get kidnapped by Martians? And after his rookie season, and then he came back and got transported back to Earth this year? Mm-hmm. Because there's a difference. The difference is that they're winning, and the difference is they're running the football lights out again.
Yep.
So Baker's what I always thought he was. Baker's a front runner. And as long as things are going well, Baker's going to be at the front of the line. But when things are not going well, he taking shots at every person that has a comment, analyst or commentator on television about talking about something about him. But Baker has not changed in my eyes. Baker's a front runner. He's playing well this year, but let's not let that fool us and make us forget about what he actually truly is.
Mm. Which is what?
Front running. I think he's a front running right now game manager. I'd be interested to see, because let's just say for the sake of argument, he had the running game of Kansas City.
Mm.
You think Baker Mayfield is throwing 4 touchdowns in the first half? You think he's putting up the numbers that he puts up? Because we saw when Chubb was out what he looked like. We saw that.
Okay. I cannot refute one thing that you said. And to pile on this point, Baker even said yesterday of the GQ interview, which was back in 2019 after his rookie year run, obviously.
He's feeling good about himself because you're going to make most touchdown passes by a rookie quarterback in NFL history.
But Baker said yesterday, reporters and media will do anything to come up with a clickbait story. No, not
true. You said it.
No, you said it. You did think it wasn't quite on the record because the interview hadn't quite started yet.
Right.
But joke's on you.
Yes.
You said it. And you meant it. And you should own it, but he won't. Okay. I don't like any of this, but I still love Baker. And the problem with Baker is, he can't stay out of his own way when things start going right, because this is who he is. This is what drives him to be successful. He wasn't a one-time walk-on. He was a two-time walk-on. Mm-hmm. When has that ever happened? He
Never.
Walked on to Texas Tech and fell apart with Cliff Kingsbury and said, okay, heck with you. I'm going to go where my father went. I'm just going to go walk on at Oklahoma and say, hey, can I play?
Right.
That's basically, he lived in the student dorm, not the athletic dorm,
right.
His first year. What? And all he did was win the Heisman Trophy.
Yes.
Okay.
That's
so
pretty good.
It's pretty good.
Hey, very many walk-ons that won the Heisman.
Yet, what happened along the way? Well, we talk about all the incidents. One time he's just didn't like TCU running a lap around his end of the field warming up in Norman, Oklahoma. So he just drilled one of the Horned Frogs right in the helmet with a pass. I mean, he nailed him.
Yes.
This is a great throw. Might have been his best throw.
Oh, yeah.
Day.
That was from about 40, 50.
Nailed him. I can't remember if it knocked him down or not, but it rang his bell.
Of course.
Yep. And then at Kansas, one of the Kansas captains wouldn't shake hands, and so Baker's over there during the game, and Kansas was terrible, and it was a mismatch, and he's making gestures across the field.
Correct.
That we can't talk about. And then, for some reason that I cannot explain, he and his then-girlfriend went to Fayetteville, Arkansas to party for the weekend, and one thing led to another, and he had a couple too many to drink, and he's running from the police and got thrown up against a retaining wall. Mm-hmm. Could have gone real bad. We've gone through this here lately, talking about what could happen if his skin color were different.
Yes.
But the point was, he did get that close to real danger.
Correct.
And I think that shook him up, but it didn't cure him. Because at heart, I'm going to use the one word I can use on television. He's just a jerk. You know, he's got that in him.
Yeah.
There's probably a better word for it that I can't say.
Yeah.
Right? But it propels him. It fuels him. it's chip on shoulder. And you're right, he front runs, but he's a really good front runner.
Yeah.
And now we're back to the Joe Judge comment. Well, we had Charlie Weiss on the show before that draft. He sat right there.
Yes.
Another chip off the old Belichick block from the coaching tree of New England. Mm-hmm. And so is Joe Judge. And Charlie Weiss just said that it was maybe the day after the semifinal game they lost. It was an overtime loss to Georgia.
Yeah,
remember this?
He said he would take him.
Said, that's that guy.
Yeah.
I want that guy number one. Why? It's attitude. Yeah. Just the way he plays. His competitiveness. Mm-hmm. So Joe Judge goes expletive and had to apologize for it. But I love the effing attitude he plays with. Elite competitor. I agree. Mm-hmm. I buy that. Coaches gravitate to that because you can't teach or coach that, right? It's something you're born with. It's just instilled in you. It's part of the fabric of how you play football. And coaches are fueled by watching him be fueled by it because too many quarterbacks are too nonchalant, too blasé, that they don't come with wearing it on their sleeves, mm-hmm. which is contagious for the rest of the team.
Correct.
Okay, so it's funny, the reporter here points out, Joe Judge has never said anything that complimentary about Daniel Jones. Well, there's some quality in Baker that he doesn't see yet in Daniel
that
Jones.
That Daniel Jones doesn't possess.
Doesn't have, right?
Yes, yeah.
Okay, so here we go with Baker. And he's trying to sort of walk back the first quote on Daniel. So he's talking about, I admire him, and he can really move when he got the ball, when he takes off.
Tucks it and run.
But then he couldn't help himself. And in midstream, he has to stop and take a shot about how he tripped over the 5-yard line.
Right.
Right?
Yeah.
Well, it's just wrong, and it won't do you any good. It didn't mend any fence with Daniel Jones. And if I'm Daniel Jones and I read that, then I would have an attitude going into this game.
But, Skip, you've already told me how you felt when you didn't think you were being recorded or you didn't think anybody was going to hear what you said.
Yeah.
You already said how you felt about me.
Mm-hmm.
I can't believe they took that guy.
Yeah.
That's how you truly feel.
That where they missed the mark in pro football evaluating college quarterbacks is his point was to that interviewer, GQ, it was Clay Skipper back in 2019, was that they missed the mark because it's all about winning. Baker did win at Oklahoma, but most quarterbacks at Oklahoma are probably going to win, right? But he boiled it down to that because Daniel Jones played at Duke where they weren't very good.
Right. And Skip, if you just based it on winning, Alabama quarterbacks would be number one every year because that's all they do is win.
You could make that case.
But that's not, you have to evaluate on other things also. But I also think, Skip, you look at Daniel Jones and they said, hold on, ain't no other guy he got playing with going to be in the NFL. So imagine if you gave him NFL receivers, an NFL running back, an NFL offensive line, this kid might be really special. It's not like a situation where you had Peyton Manning and Peyton Manning, had Peerless Price and had, Jamal Lewis and had guys around him.
At Tennessee.
Like, yeah. But, sometimes, I think that's the hardest part to analyze of a quarterback, Skip. A guy, because like you said about Tua, well, how do you really evaluate Tua? Well, you're going to have five guys go in the first round at wide receiver, and you're going to have two, three offensive linemen that go top 10, top 15, and you got two running backs. So how do we fairly evaluate him?
Najee Harris is really good. He might be a first-round pick.
Yeah, so how do we fully evaluate him versus a guy like Daniel Jones, who 6'5", 235, can throw
I got it, and I watched him, four or five times at Duke. Never caught my eye, never registered that he'd be anything more than a fifth or sixth round pick.
I'm not so sure if David Cutcliffe was not his head coach.
I agree.
And he hadn't coached Peyton Manning and Eli Manning.
Yep.
I'm not so sure he's a first rounder.
Well, I will be the first to say he's been much better than I thought he could be because he is very athletic.
Yes.
And he's more reserved competitive, but I think he's got a hot streak in him.
Until he learns to take care of the football, he'll never reach potential.
Yep. But he has talent.
Oh, yeah. He can throw it. He can run, obviously. But, Skip, them turnovers.
No, won't work. Mm. Well, that's the one thing Baker this year has finally eliminated. Yes.
Thank you for watching. You can subscribe here to get the latest from the show. And be sure to check out more of the best clips from Undisputed or go watch a few other segments from our other shows on FS1.